Hi, everyone, again, and welcome to Accelerate's Talking Talent Masterclass for recruiters on assertiveness and stakeholder management. I'm Milda, I'm the head of marketing at Accelerate, and I'll be the moderator today. For all of the first-time joiners, thank you for joining, and who have been participating in our previous Talking Talent events, welcome back. Before I kick off, I would like to give a short introduction to Accelerate and our today's panelists. So, Accelerate is a recruiting as a service firm with a mission to change how startups scale. We support our clients on site by becoming part of their team so we can hire great people. Feel free to reach out to any of us after this webinar if you have any questions, need to hire better, or are searching for a job in recruiting and you are willing to take this next step in your career. And now I'd really like to welcome our speakers today. So first of all, welcome Cinzia. She's a talent partner at Accelerate. She comes from in-house recruiting and has a background in sales. Cinzia brings her know-how in the commercial hiring that she built over the 5+ years. And Cinzia has worked with the European and US-based startups and scale-ups and is now working at Accelerate for the last 2 years. Just recently, she celebrated her 2-year mark at Accelerate, and currently she's working with a great client called Frontify. Cinzia loves great food and is a big fan of handcraft and hobbies. So welcome, Cinzia. And Estelle is an engagement manager at Accelerate, and she started her career in tech recruiting 8+ years ago. And she started as an agency recruiter first, worked across French, Spanish, and Swiss markets. Afterwards, she joined Accelerate, and she's with us for 3.5 years already. At Accelerate, she started as a talent partner and worked mostly with Series A and B startups, hiring for product and tech teams. So here you also have a commercial recruiter and a tech and product recruiter. And afterwards, she became an engagement manager at Accelerate. She's a big fan of music, likes classical music, Latin and jazz, and does that in her free time. So welcome both. Really excited to kick this off today. And here's how the session will go. So during the first half an hour, Estelle and Cinzia will give you an extensive training on stakeholder management. And then afterwards, we'll move into a Q&A session. So how that will go is that in Zoom, you can click on the feature, raise your hand. Once you will raise your hand, I will say, hey, I'm unmuting you, and then name. And then you'll be able to ask your question to both Cinzia and Estelle. And otherwise, enjoy the session. Feel free to ask questions throughout in the chat function. Our accelerators will also be there to answer your questions. So with no further ado, Cinzia and Estelle, please feel free to take it away.
Thanks a lot for the intro, Milda. So we are gonna start with defining stakeholder management with a couple of stories and quotes. From our clients and from us. First, let us remind the learning goals of today. It's to understand the mindset and methodology of stakeholder management, to give you very concrete tools to bring and act on from tomorrow, refine your stakeholder analysis, and learn in general about best practices to offer a great experience to hiring managers and candidates. So yeah, agenda, story time, stakeholder management essentials, stakeholder management for hiring managers, stakeholder management for candidates, and yes, the Q&A. So we can start with a story. I can kick off if you want. I'll start with a failure in stakeholder management. I started at Accelerate 3.5 years ago at HelloFresh, and I was coming from agency recruitment. I didn't know how to work with internal hiring managers. And what I didn't do correctly is inform them about my progress. So I was hardworking, but I didn't inform about how many people I was contacting, about the markets, and it takes me a lot of time to build trust. It takes me 2 months instead of building trust from week one. It's something I always remembered, and I never did the same mistake again. On the success side, that was for Grover. So here the key learning was understand the priorities of your stakeholders and adapt to the priorities. They were on a phase on a Series A, and we didn't have a lot of time to hire. We had to scale fast. So what they wanted, basically a recruiter who releases the pressure, arrives with a solution, and understands the high stake of recruitment. Here, that was about reassuring and proposing solutions. That was the greatest stakeholder experience I provided. And the very big lesson, it really encourages me to keep learning about stakeholder management now. So yeah, I will let the mic to Cynthia for other stories.
Yeah, so I'm eventually the real Cinzia in the call, wearing red, just to confirm it. So I also will like to start with a failure. So, well, not a failure, but more like a learning step in my career. So it was my second month as a recruiter, and I had to immediately work with a very difficult stakeholder. You really had a high expectation from me, but I was very inexperienced. I was just starting, right? So I was not really ready to deal with ambiguity and with, you know, constant changing. I was not seeing the bigger picture of the recruitment processes. So if I look back at this step or this moment, I took it as a learning moment, because it's clear that it made me realize that setting the right expectations from day one, it's super important and will make sure that the relationship with your hiring manager is smooth and concrete. On the success part, it's more like a recent success. So in summer 2020, I had the chance to work with a client called Qualifies. They're based in Frankfurt. They have an office in Barcelona. And previously, they used the Accelerate for hiring their CTO. So I jumped in as an embedded recruiter. I had to hire many salespeople for their team. And we succeed. And they had amazing talent on board. And yeah, after 3 months, the collaboration ended. But after a year, the founder, one of the founders, David, contacted me again and said, okay, we want you again. Are you available? And at the time, I was not available. So we had to, you know, make it work. And the success is that now they are using again our service. And we hope to succeed again with them. So we have asked to a couple of our clients to share with us some quotes about the stakeholder manager and what is important for them. So Fabian Rudolph is eventually the person I report to as of now, because I'm embedded at Frontify. And she says that communication is key. So be proactive, share ideal profiles, but also share the effort that you did and share what the market responds to make sure that also you are aware of, you know, the business that you're working with. So that's how you gain the trust of your hiring manager.
And we also ask Anna Grunler from DeepSet, what is stakeholder management for her? We picked her brain on the topic because she's, you know, she's head of operation at DeepSet. She's holding the company at high scale at the moment. She's a master at stakeholder management, both internally and for Accelerate. And for her, she defines it as a bi-directional relationship. I think it's really interesting that approach, both on a recruiter and hiring manager, should be, you know, win-win situation. And for her, stakeholder management is about two things: the mindset and the methodology. So in the next slide, we are going to explore a bit the methodology of stakeholder management. And after that, dig a bit on the mindset. So here we want to give you the stakeholder management essentials, so tools you can bring on from tomorrow and work with to be a better stakeholder manager. The first essential of stakeholder management is to work on your emotional intelligence. It's based on 5 key criteria. The first one is motivation. So basically, people with high EQ, so high stakeholder management, are people who see the big picture. They don't work for themselves or for short-term results. They work for the long-term results. Second component, and very important one, is self-awareness. Know your feeling, strength, weakness, and react, because it will bring you much more openness also to over the feeling and much more adaptability. Third component, and second most important, is empathy. So the capacity to foresee the needs and feeling of others and your own needs. This is really a key component of building any great stakeholder relationship. Why? Because you will adapt to what your stakeholder feels and needs. Second other component would be self-regulation. Quite a hard one for me, I have to admit. It's about controlling your emotions during conflicts, during tough conversations, during stressful time. It's really important to, you know, appease your stakeholder and maintain consistent relationships. And finally, last components are social skills. So how do you maintain and nurture your relationships, basically? We are going to see how to boost your emotional intelligence. So the first thing to do is always to transform self-deception into self-awareness. It's easy as a recruiter to, you know, to be very self-centric when there is a failure, offer are rejected, or something is going wrong in the process. Actually, use that deceptive time to raise your self-awareness, strengths, weaknesses, and see the role you could have played in the whole situation. First thing to do. Second is to adopt an over-centric mindset. So when something is going wrong, really try to identify not only what you influence, but also how others are influenced by the situation. Third element would be to be rewarding and trusting. It's quite, you know, in stressful time especially, it's quite easy to make hires, but not take the time to sit back and thank the whole team who is advocating you to make this hire happens as well. This will really build a long-term trust in your relationships. Then stay humble. Be aware that it's not only your success, again, but also the success of a whole system of whole relationships around you. And last and most important element is to assess your emotional intelligence skills at least every 6 months. So we are going to send you a test as a goodie at the end of the masterclass to assess your self-awareness, self-regulation, social skills, relationship management. It's super, super, it's an eye-opener. And we advise you to do for yourself, but also to give the test to one of your partners and to compare the results. It's very, very fun exercise. So still to go on EQ, but with empathy map. How to develop your empathy using a simple empathy map every time you start a new project or you lack understanding on a role or candidates before retrospectives or hiring catch-ups. It will help you to identify your user goals and needs and to have a very accurate picture of what they think about the process, how they feel, what they're doing, what they say. It will be a very helpful tool to adapt and personalize the experience you have with them. So you will receive also templates and you can do the exercise yourself from tomorrow. Another very, very important component of stakeholder management is how to give and receive feedback. So at Accelerate, we love using a radical candor methodology because it doesn't only give you a great methodology for feedback, it also shows you what is wrong. So here we can define it a bit. So radical candor is basically a direct, kind, and sincere way to give feedback. It's a perfect balance to give and receive and asking feedback. While using radical candor, it establishes trust. You know, when someone steps up to give you feedback, you are like, whoa, okay, I can really partner with that person. It raises your self-awareness, teamwork. It's the key to manage conflict. And when to use it anytime, basically, when you ask for feedback, when giving feedback, when you want to assess feedback, and when you want to praise people. What we absolutely want to avoid is realness, empathy, manipulative insincerity of obnoxious aggression. Obnoxious aggression is when, you know, you deliver feedback without caring. So really, bam, harsh criticism. Manipulative insincerity is when you give, when you praise someone publicly, but harsh critique behind their back. And realness, empathy, I guess it's the most common one and quite a hard one to fight, is that you care so much about the person that will sugarcoat your feedback or not be direct enough. And this is also a big, big failure. So yeah, we really encourage you to use radical candor, find the perfect balance, and to have a look at their website because you have tons of free resources and guides to help you giving feedback in a better way. Some radical candor basics. So feedback structure. The first rule when giving feedback is to write it and prepare it and to follow situation, behavior, impact, or when giving praise, the core feedback. So context, observation, results, and next step. So the second thing is to be HIIPP. Humble, helpful, immediate feedback in person, public praise, but private criticism, and that is never about personality. I'm sure it already happened to you. It happened to me that sometimes when you give feedback to someone, we tend to say, hey, you are so judgmental. No, actually what we should say is that when you say that, it makes me feel like you are judgmental. So very different approach. So yeah, these are the basics of radical candor. We can move to the next slide. Yeah, another important tool is stakeholder analysis. This is what Anna from DZ advises to use. So here, when you start a new hiring project, make sure you define your stakeholder. Who do you have to manage closely? Who do you have to keep satisfied? Who do you monitor? Who do you keep informed? Why is it important to get ahead of the game and to directly adapt your communication to different stakeholders? It's also helpful to win resources. If you adapt your communication, you have more. Sorry, I see Estelle are taking notes. Could you speak? Ah, okay. Yes. Thank you. Yeah. I will try to pace myself. Thanks a lot. Yeah, so more time for interviews, more advice, and more engagement in general. Here, I included an example of stakeholders for a recruiter, but you can adapt it to your own situations. When to use it? So yeah, when you start a new project, when you need to reprioritize, and when you want to draft a stakeholder communication plan. Here, I can send you more details at the end of the masterclass, but basically it's a table where you put name of the stakeholder, his or she's your advocate, supporter, critic, blocker, and the action plan in your communication to make people be your advocate every time. We can move to the next slide. Yeah, other important communication trick for stakeholder management is the Minto pyramid. When to use it for C-levels who don't have time at all to listen to plenty of details and to be more impactful in your communication. So we will show you an example in the next slide, actually. So here you can compare yourself to different styles. One narrative style, the one we tend to use on our daily life, which starts with all the details and then the conclusion. VS the pyramid style, who starts with the conclusion and after that the details. So here, for example, we say, imagine the CTO is in a meeting with you and he asks you, what is the status of the dropouts in hiring? If you use the pyramid style, you will directly jump to the hypothesis. We think the candidates drop out because of the tech assessment. First, hiring data shows that. Second, the candidate feedback shows that. Third, we run a retrospective and it has been confirmed by the team that they don't have enough time to review the tech assessment. Then we go to the solution. We are currently working on resource allocation to reduce the time to review the technical tests and reduce the dropouts in hiring. Why is it important to use that? Because simply it creates more impact for your stakeholder. It's easier to follow and it creates more confidence also in your way of speaking. It's not easy to use it every day. It takes time and weeks of practice to adopt that style. So here, Sam, we encourage you to dig a bit more into Minto's principle because it's really eye-opening to find the root cause and communicate. Yeah, and finally, another important tool is to disarm your stakeholder stress. Here, I took two scenarios. It's a really big topic, but we wanted to give the basics. One is stress management. So if you notice that one of your hiring manager or one of your candidates is stressed, the first thing to do is acknowledge the stress. How? Giving them space to express their stress, being seen and heard. Very important. And here we advise you to use neutral comments. So for example, yeah, that might be really hard. You have multiple balls to juggle instead of, oh, yeah, that company is killing you. I don't know how you stand it, for example. Second step is to praise the person. When you are stressed, you feel, undermined. You don't feel confident. And it's always good to have a partner who shows you what you are doing great. So if you have a hiring manager completely stressed out, praise him or her and remind him or her what they are doing great. First step is offer support. You can't always provide support, but just the fact of proposing it appeases the tensions and they feel they have a partner with them. Then break down requests. When you work with highly stressed hiring manager, make sure that you don't overwhelm the person with tons of information. Group them and allow specific times to share that information. It will clear their cognitive space and it will release a lot of tensions. Very, very useful when we work with early stage startups here. Another important element is don't judge them because I heard recruiters sometimes say, it's impossible to work with that hiring manager. It's too stressful. But actually we shouldn't judge because we also would react the same in their situation sometimes. Very important to remember. On the other hand, if you have a conflicted conversation, bring clarity in the conversation. So don't over sugarcoat, state the why you are having a conversation at the moment. tone is quite hard to do, but stay calm as much as possible and really pace your body language. Otherwise, you risk to escalate the conflict even more. Third is temperance. So really, really measure your words. It's, you know, sometimes in conflict, we want to win points, but actually we should always try to be the one mediating and tempering. So instead of saying, stop interrupting me, say, can you please hold on 1 minute? Otherwise I will lose my train of thoughts. Not easy to do, but quite efficient. Then acknowledge your part of responsibility to focus the attention of the listener. Restate your intentions. Restate that it's for the good of the hiring process that we are having that conversation. It's not personal, it's not against you. Really important. And don't assume the listener knows everything that you mean. So take time to explain also the situation and your point of view. Because conflict escalates the moment you assume other person already know what you are about to say or you already know how the person would react to what you'll say. So yeah, that was it about stakeholder management essentials. I hope you learned a couple of new things.
So now we will go a little bit deeper into the stakeholder management topic about the hiring managers and how to deal with them, how to collaborate with them. And Estelle mentioned to be their partner, to be their right arm, and to work together to succeed. So I do have a question just to break the ice also for me. So the question would be, what are the top three soft skills you need to manage hiring managers? So you can definitely answer maybe in the chat, and we can also take those answer. Oh, I see something coming. That's listening. Patient, empathy, definitely. So maybe keep them coming, and then we can maybe look at them later when we have the Q&A. I see, great. Active communication, amazing. So we can go to the next slide. So we kind of ask the same question internally at Accelerate, and we receive some nice answers that we turn into quotes. So always be trustful, even if it's uncomfortable. So we always deal with difficult stakeholders, difficult hiring managers, but be real, share the truth out of it. But also be proactive in the process. Try to think one step ahead at all times. So drive the car and don't let the car drive you. So if you will be able to actually plan in advance the blockers or what can go wrong, what maybe you have an experienced hiring manager, train them, make sure that they are ready to go. But also use the three also, listen, lead, and don't lie. Because, if you lie, you will always be cut afterwards, believe me. And go into every meeting with a clear plan, never overpromise, and work hard in the early days for them to gain the confidence in you. So let them, trust you, but also don't overpromise really, because then it's gonna go against you afterwards. So we have seen, and I'm sure that you have seen in your hiring experience and as a recruiter, common friction. So definitely communication gaps between the hiring manager. If you don't have a real, connection, is gonna go bad somehow. You will be not having the trust. So you will have a trust breakdown. And this could also come from a big misalignment. So maybe also about the unrealistic expectations. So if you remember my story time, put the expectations as your priority number one when you discuss with the hiring manager the first time. And it's also possible that you have mismatched incentives. So maybe we are not having the right budgets for the role. Maybe we are not paying enough. So look at the data, the benchmarking, what the market is giving, and plan accordingly. So if we move to the next slide. We have some communication guidelines to share that for us are very relevant and very helpful. So definitely get and stay close with the hiring managers and get to know them also about what's their life after work, because they might have a family, they might have, I don't know, great hobbies that you can have in common with. So get really close to them. Estelle mentioned also before, empathy. Bring it to every meeting with the hiring manager, but also adapt your communication style because every person is different and you will have to adapt with them. Regarding assertiveness, well, I'm sure the active listen, I saw it coming in the chat, but also being open to give and to receive feedback. So use maybe the empathy map and the feedback, model that that we shared before to help you out. And I think it's also important to have open brainstorming session. They could be, you know, round tables or retrospective where you really go through what's going well, what's not going well, and what we should potentially start to do from tomorrow. And I think having weekly catch-ups with the hiring manager will help you to, you know, getting to know them, to show what's the pipeline looking like, you know, talking about making decision about candidates and so on. So what was also important is to create and share common goals. And this is also getting to the expectations. If this is clear, then you are good to go. And we can also go to the next slide. So it's important to build trust from day one with your hiring manager, because if they trust you, they will give you the white paper. So they will give you the full, overview of doing whatever you feel that is good in that moment. So do a research. So be prepared on every meeting that you do, have a clear agenda, take notes, put down action points, and don't really assume if you don't know something about the role that you're working on, about the candidate, about the hiring process, but ask questions instead. And I know that reading their minds it's a bit tricky and it's also powerful, but maybe you can use the empathy map to help you out. And as I mentioned before, also maybe you can, I don't know, prevent the blockers and the obstacles that you could actually face. And we know that part of our job is also planning and scheduling, and it takes a lot of time. So be aware of their time, but also yours. What is also important is to customize the interaction with each hiring manager. I said before, not everyone is the same, and you need to adapt again. And collect data. Collecting data is super important because those data, they will help you out in case, you have some blockers about, salary budgets or sourcing targets that maybe you didn't reach, why, and so on. So collect the data throughout the process and you will be, able to succeed. So we also, talk about realistic expectation. This is happening quite often, to be honest. And you should, tackle these problems since the day one. So set the priorities and ask the hiring manager, okay, we have 10 roles. What's the priority number one? What is the most important, role that you have to fill as of now? Because they always want us to hire for yesterday, not tomorrow. So ask them and set also clear expectation regarding your sourcing targets, but also when this person needs to start and who are the interviewers of the hiring process. If you have this clear information, this is also very helpful. And, some hiring managers are very new to hiring. So train them and make sure that they have the right information about also the kickoff, how to kick off a new role, which kind of information they have to provide you, but also maybe provide them interview questions and hiring guides. So what can they ask and what they cannot ask during an interview? especially regarding the, you know, work law topic and the market data. So as I mentioned before, having the data from the market, it's super important. So who can we actually hire? Is the budget eventually matching the seniority of the role that we are trying to hire? And how competitive we are? Are we having the right benefits? Or are we having the right, you know, growth opportunities? And can we compromise? If yes, where? So discuss with the hiring manager about this as well. Next slide. So we usually have it accelerate a kickoff template that we use with every new role that we kick off. And usually it's we sit down with the hiring manager and we gather as much as information as possible to make sure that we adjust our sourcing strategy and expectation accordingly as well. And as I said, build or review scorecards. Because sometimes they have no idea what to ask or when to ask. So do that for them. And I think one of the most important is also the calibration part. So provide them a few profiles to make sure that we are aligned, that we are looking for the same people. Because it happened many times that I started the search and they said, no, but this is not what we're looking for. And I'm like, what? Okay, let's start again. So if you have this at the beginning of the process, is going to be way better. And also the decision process, it's quite important. So make sure that every interviewer, not only the hiring manager, is filling the feedback, the scorecard, let's say. You should also organize like debriefing where all the interviewers are part of and you discuss about each candidate you have put together into the hiring process. And have a final decision. So obviously this will help you out also organizing weekly catch-ups and hiring retrospective. This will help you through the entire process. And make sure to have an open communication. So this keep them informed during the whole process. Don't let them wait or not being aware of what's going on. Over communicate if you can. This is my ultimate advice. And we also have like a gather some toolkit that we usually use with our hiring manager. So besides learning the inside out of your ATS that the company is using, it's having the great tool to communicate with the hiring manager. So lately I've seen one of my hiring manager using Miro boards, which was quite interesting. But you could use a Notion for documenting everything. You can use the Talent Wall as a pipeline collaboration. Calendly is usually used maybe to schedule calls for them. Fellow could be used for one-on-ones, so you have notes, action points, and have everything in one place. And Asana, it's more maybe for projects with the hiring manager, but you can also put candidates and put them, in different steps. So, yeah. Oh. Then we can move to the next slide, if we can.
Yes, is the screen back?
Yes. So, remember that the hiring manager, they need us as much as we need them. So if you go fast, they also go fast. And if you are flexible, they're also flexible. And if you show that you are there for them, they will be there for you. So they need us and we need them.
Nice, thank you. So sorry, I had a lot of coffee apparently, so I'll try to pace down this part. So now we are going to talk about candidates, around stakeholder management. So common frictions we identify are communication gaps, misalignments, lengthy processes, rejection calls, I think no one likes to do them, and offer management. So in the next slide, we are going to see operational solutions for each one of the scenarios. So communication gaps, some recruiters or some interviewers forget to do sometimes is to reiterate the company vision and role and how the candidate will contribute to the vision. So what we advise here is really to encourage and train every interviewer to link the role to the vision every time. Then compensation and perks. I was impressed by smart recruiters because they have really clear salary ranges defined for every country with the perks accessible to everyone. And it really helps, you know, the recruiter to have all the details when entering in a conversation. They also have really great guidelines on how to disclose this information and at which moment of the process. So I encourage each recruiter here to, you know, take the time to document it very clearly, even if we have a lot of priorities at the same time. Then equity and shares. So here it's always, you know, quite kind of a tricky topic. What we notice is that the policy is not always really defined. So for example, they don't always know for what kind of level or what kind of candidates we give equity or shares. What are the conditions? After how long do we receive them? So here, same. We encourage you to sit down with the C-level team and really clean it and have very clear guidelines. It will avoid bad surprises for candidates. And same, yeah, documentation is key on this topic. Then visa, remote, and contracts. Visa information, remote work mindset should be checked from the first call with your candidates. Really, you know, really take time to dig into that and follow up on this topic all along the process. Here, same, we should have a standardized process documented, including all the special cases, so that you are able to answer the candidate in any situation. Why is that important? Because if you want to manage a candidate and create trust, you need to be the partner who knows all the details and will reassure. When you have the budget, we advise to consider third-party providers to make the experience much smoother. So remotemore.com, for example, localize, Papaya, yeah, if you have plenty of providers, we can talk about it after also. And with remote work at the moment, we know that the moment the candidate accepts the offer to the moment he or she signs, it's quite a long time, 2 to 3 weeks sometimes. So in those cases, really remember to keep the candidate warm and reassure, because this is the moment you might lose the candidate. We can move to the next slide. So yeah, how to avoid misalignment with the candidates. We assume sometimes that you know, the candidates know how our hiring process works. Actually, no, and even if they know, sometimes they have 10 processes at the same time. So what we advise to do here is really to take time to draft confirmation emails, to create interview preparation packages for the candidates, to really tell them these are the goals and skills assessed during the interview step, not leave them in the dark, provide them really details, them to release stress and to create a seamless candidate experience. Very important, I know we are all super busy, but it's extremely important to give timely feedback. If you say we'll come back to you tomorrow, you actually have to come back to the candidate tomorrow, otherwise you break the trust. Then title and seniority. Here I've heard a couple of examples where offer were rejected because the candidate was supposed to have a senior role offered and only had a mid-level role after the technical assessment. Here, Sam, sit down with your hiring manager and prepare all these case scenarios. If you see that the candidate is not ready for a senior role, inform him or her as soon as possible before reaching out the offer call. Otherwise, I think it's a deal breaker for them. And take time to clearly review the growth plans to be able to communicate it with candidates. What we all want when we change job is a perspective and see how we contribute to a vision and how we are going to grow. I insist on that because at Bover, for example, we tended to want to hire very fast and we lost candidates because of that lack of clarity. The moment we sat down and documented everything, sent those packages to the candidates, we had an offer acceptance rate went from 80% to 90%. And finally, like debrief call with candidates. I know, Sam, we don't have a lot of time, but we should always pick up our phone when the candidate agrees and check in after every interview how the candidate feels. What are areas of concerns? Do they have other offers? What are questions on compensation, perks, location? We have to be patient and provide as much information as needed. At Bover, part of the reason of the high success is because the C-level never refused a small call if a candidate had extra questions. This is really, really important and can have a huge impact. So yeah, here we also have the case where recruiters need to shorten the process. You have some very operational techniques, like for example, replacing the tech assessment with a live assessment. It's debatable, it depends on your hiring team as well. With the current market, we realize that it should be 2-3 weeks maximum to hire a candidate. If delays are longer, you should review the process and if delays are longer before the offer is signed and the contract, inform and reassure the candidates. What Ojar is doing is really awesome. They created SLAs accessible to everyone, head of people, head of TA, interviewers, hiring manager, recruiters, that they have to respect. And everyone is keeping each other accountable to have these delays. What we advise to do is here to draft a candidate journey with the timeline between every step and what they have to take between every step and keep people accountable on following these timelines. So yeah, we can talk about it later. It's a long topic, but yeah, I find it quite useful and really have it documented and train everyone regularly on these timelines. Of course, if you see that someone has troubles, think about the root cause and try to facilitate the process. So for example, grouping all interviews on one day or having interview blockers can be super useful. Same for the candidates. I always ask in the follow-up, when would be a good time for you to meet? And pre-plan times, it can make the process smoother and faster. Okay, sorry. Another area of pain is giving feedback to candidates. So we can go to next slide. Here are the do's and don'ts. So the do's, I guess we all know how to do it. It happened to me once not to prepare a feedback for a quite senior candidates because I had too many roles at the same time and I didn't take time to do it. It fired back quite badly. So yeah, prepare your feedback. If you don't have enough details, go to your hiring manager and prepare it with the HM. Always provide clear reasons. Give space for the candidate to express themselves, anger, areas of improvement, ask their feedback on the hiring process, and either hiring manager in feedback for senior hires. I agree, yeah, it should be a video call, yes, 100%, especially now that everyone has a bit more space with remote work, yes, I agree. Don't give approximate feedback, don't speed up the call. So it's very tempting because you know, it's never a good moment, but actually, we have time to deliver feedback. Don't procrastinate the call. The longer you wait, the worse it is. Don't apologize. I've heard recruiters apologizing for the feedback. It's not your fault, actually. So don't give the candidate that the ascendant on you. It's not on you. And don't treat it lightly. Don't say, I have too much work. I will just send an email. No, never, because your reputation is in stake here. And a candidate you reject once can be actually a candidate hired in 6 months, 1 year, 2 years. We can move to the next slide. Yeah, here I really wanted to give a shout out to Daniel, actually, who is in the call, I think. This is a message you receive from a candidate after giving feedback. So yes, giving feedback, rejection feedback is very tough, but it has an immense impact on some people's life. So I'll let you read the email here. You see that thanks to a great recruiter feedback, the candidate could advance in his career. Yeah, we can move on. Yeah, and last chunk is offer management. So here we could do a whole masterclass around the topic. Here what we learned from Julia is how to establish trust from day one. So here, don't treat the first call as a transactional relationship, but it's the moment you have to really be a career coach almost. Really take time to dig into motivation, drivers, why the candidate wants to change, what kind of culture he or she wants to create, what are practicalities, and share all this information to next interviewers to make sure they don't re-ask questions. Otherwise, your trust is a bit broken as well. Second part is facilitating the offer. So it's quite tempting with the VATS and automation to just follow up with emails. That's really what we said earlier, is that planning video calls to follow up between every step is super important to realign an expectation and reinforce trust. The first step and the most painful and most important one is the famous offer call. So here, we can give a lot of advices, but what we say is always prepare the negotiation, know all details, involve hiring manager, don't do it alone, you are a team with them, and make sure you check over offers, over processes before the offer call, very important. We also created an offer checklist, and it really helps before jumping on a call, okay, do I have all elements? If you don't have all elements for the negotiation, go back to it and take more time to prepare. We can move to next slides. offer called tips from Accelerate Team. So first of all, have templates ready. Why? Because it's just a security chat to make sure you have everything ready. The first advice we ask is always to ask an open question in that offer call. How do you feel about the hiring process? Pick up on everything the candidate says and answer. Always link the offer and what the company can offer to the candidate motivations and value. Then always try to make the candidate give three yeses. So are you happy with the value of the company? Are you happy with the team? Are you happy with how the product will be built? Yes, okay. After that, you deliver the offer per se and make sure here you know exactly all the details, holidays, salaries, equities, growth plan, evolution of the role, everything. And finally, give a deadline to the candidate, because you will feel it. Like, when do you think you can give the answer? You will feel if it's 1 week, potentially you have a problem here, depending on the candidate. If the candidate is more inclined to give the answer quite fast, in 2 days, it's maybe a good sign. So here it will help you assess. And again, another really, really important element, as always, is to be a trusted partner. So when you deliver the offer, make sure also to deliver it from a career perspective. What will the company bring in terms of career to the candidates? That's it. What candidates, a very interesting quote from Chido, talent partner at Accelerate. Hiring is not a transactional relationship. Be genuinely interested in helping candidates have the next great step of their career. And this is a moment you will have a great stakeholder management with candidates, actually, quite naturally. We should always have their best interest in mind, yes. So I go, Chin, the mic is yours.
Yeah. So I will basically wrap up. So we'll go into the Q&A very fast. We hope that either you have learned something new or you have refreshed your knowledge listening to us. Our advice is never stop learning or informing yourself or joining our next masterclass. You will also be, we will follow up with a guide on the topic that we tackled today. But in the meantime, if you have any question, feel free to contact me or Estelle on LinkedIn, or maybe you will get our email somewhere and we can discuss further. Yeah.
Thank you, Chinzen. And thank you, Estelle. So during the time, we actually got a couple of questions coming our way via chat and Q&A. So I'd like to sort of start. I think the first question is for you, Chinze. Is it better for a hiring manager or the recruiter to make the offer or manage the offer? And how would you approach that?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So I think it depends on the seniority of the role that you are hiring for. Lately I'm taking care of, for example, director roles. And in that case, I think it would be much more value if the hiring manager, so their future potential manager, will give the offer. Or you could eventually start to do the offer and then organize a follow-up, meeting if they have any questions or specification about the offer. So it really depends. But depends mostly on the seniority, in my opinion.
Estelle, do you have anything to add on this topic?
To add in particular, it was a great answer.
Okay, awesome. So Annie asked a question. I'd like to pose it to both of you. What if the company's leadership team advises us not to give constructive feedback to the candidates, for example, to avoid legal issues? How can you approach the situation and how would you handle it? Estelle, maybe we could start with you.
I think that's why the feedback should never be written via email, but always delivered on a video call. That's the only way to protect yourself legally. And after, if you have, it's extreme cases, but if you have a candidate who is a bit, overly sensitive, then you can also you don't have to deliver constructive feedback, but more explain the rejection by the fact that you benchmarked over candidates that are better fits. But so that's two answers I can give, but legally you cannot write a constructive feedback by email. Otherwise, yes, the candidate can use it against you. That's why we advise to have a video call.
Yeah. Shinza, what about yourself? Do you think that it's always the case that written feedback is prone to legal issues?
I'm sure that maybe a white lie could also help giving a feedback. But in my cases, I've tried to be very open and very, you know, transparent in a way that maybe that candidate will be one of your candidates in the next project or in the next company. So, I'm sure that they will benefit either way.
Yeah. Fun fact, actually, Shinza was the first recruiter that was trying to recruit me for a completely different company. And the feedback was done directly in the call. And now I'm working at Accelerate. So I think it's a really funny situation, but feedback always sort of trumps it all. And it's a great place to sort of connect and learn and build partnerships. But moving into the next question that was just posed was, what some of the best practices when hiring remote hybrid for remote hybrid setup and managing your stakeholders when you're hiring in a remote setup? Estelle, Cinzia, which Estelle, maybe you want to take this one first?
Yeah, I'm not sure I fully understood.
How do you manage your stakeholders in a remote or hybrid setup? It takes away maybe the face-to-face contact where becomes a little bit more difficult to read their emotions. So how do you manage your stakeholders in remote or hybrid?
Yeah, it's a very good question. It makes it harder. I think in that case, we have to be even more cautious on having privileged time with them. So when you start working with a stakeholder, pre-plan already bi-weekly meetings, for example, with hiring managers I'm talking with. If you have, I don't know, 15 roles with one HM, maybe it's worth having a stand-up with them or even join, you know, their Scrum meetings. If we talk about the TA teams, I see a lot of companies implementing daily stand-ups, even 10 minutes to keep track. And they also have weekly meetings. But in general, it's just keeping people accountable and showing them the importance of having catch-ups in videos and not only via Slack.
Shinza, do you have anything to add? I know that for Frontify, you're hiring for roles across the US and in Europe, and your hiring managers are based in different locations. How do you... manage your stakeholders across continents?
Yeah. Let's say that for me has been always like this is join Accelerate, because then we enter in the pandemic and I had to deal with clients in Frankfurt, now in Switzerland. So for me, it's to over communicate everything, mm-hmm. to update them on every step I do with the candidates. So if I have a call of, now, I will write immediately after to the hiring manager, hey, listen, I have spoken with this candidate. This is what he said, la, la, la. What should we do? And then maybe organize, a little bit more structured meeting to discuss on different topics, but over communicate all the time. Yeah.
Awesome. So I see that Isabel actually tackled one of these questions, but it's a very interesting one. So you both mentioned prioritization is very, very important. Communication, organization, prioritization. So now it's about hiring managers. And Shinza, I think you can take this one away. When you have several hiring managers and a lot of roles open, how do you prioritize then? Because it all sounds fun and dandy when you have one hiring manager, but some of the recruiters working with several. How do you prioritize roles when you have several of hiring managers?
Yeah, set up weekly calls with each of them. If they need a daily report, do it via Slack or email as they prefer. Stay close to them and answer fast and be flexible to get on a call with them. That's definitely my case. I have had plenty of managers, not only one. Make sure to give the priority to treat everyone kind of equally, and don't prefer to speak with one and not with the other one.
But would you recommend for everyone to sit down at one table, so you sort of sit down with all of the hiring managers together to figure out who has business priority, or you just treat everyone equally?
I personally, I don't let them sit down all together with me. I take them individually. But it's also up to you to really understand what's their need and what's the business need as well. Also, you need maybe to look at the hiring plan they have and decide who you have to hire on a monthly basis. So yeah, I think it's you have to see the bigger picture if you want to deal with that.
Cool. And then we'll take a final question, then we'll need to wrap up, as I just asked. Do you have any tips in managing candidates remotely, like managing them as stakeholders? Estelle, could you maybe elaborate a little bit more?
Yeah, to me, it's not really different from when we had a face-to-face market. So managing candidates remotely, I think it starts from the moment you are scheduling a call with them. So here, give them as much freedom as possible. We use Calendly to do that. They just select a slot and this is it. Maybe we should be a bit more adaptable also in our interviewing time. So leave one slot in the morning, lunch, evening. That's the first thing. Second thing, when you follow up with your candidates, I love asking in front screening, how would you like us to follow up? You know, I'm your partner here. I want the best for you. So I will support you all along the process. How should we catch up and how frequently should we catch up? And usually they tell me, yeah, WhatsApp or calls or video calls. And we pre-plan times for video calls. Usually WhatsApp is the one that works best. You say, hey, can we speak? Okay, yeah, 5 p.m. Okay, let's do it. And this is it. So yeah, it's what Cynthia said, it's about over-communicating and agree on a communication channel with the candidates. That's really consistent and make them aware that yeah, you might be in touch with them twice a week potentially to follow up. I don't know if it answers the question.
I think so. And we have a couple of minutes. So I just wanted to wrap up and thank everyone for joining. I hope that this was a very informative session. I'm reading a lot of compliments by Kimberly and so on. And thank you so much for joining. There'll be many more sessions masterclass sessions next year, where as Accelerate, we want to empower all of the recruiters to have access to the knowledge and tools to make recruiting better. In the end, we will also share the recording and there will be a blog and a guide about this session. If you want to engage more, feel free to head over to the LinkedIn event and pose the questions to the panel, of course, and other recruiters that work at Accelerate. Use this as a space to connect, chat, pose your questions, as I just mentioned. And by visiting our LinkedIn event page, you'll be able to find Cinzia's and Estelle's profiles. Feel free to connect with them and ask your questions. We're always really, really excited to connect with the community. And at the same time, if you feel like you're done with in-house and done with agency recruiting, move over to Accelerate. There's plenty to learn and we work with really, really fun startups. So thank you. And I hope to speak to you next year.